The Prince is Niccolò Machiavelli's legendary, often considered infamous, 1513 philosophical text, narrated by Machiavelli himself. Considered the father of modern political theory, Machiavelli was the defense secretary for the Florentine Republic for 14 years until the Medici family, who controlled Florence for most of the Renaissance, returned to power in 1512. When it was discovered he had attempted to organize a militia against the Medici dynasty, Machiavelli was jailed, tortured, and temporarily exiled to his father's estate just south of Florence. It was there he began writing his political treatise, The Prince, which was first published as a pamphlet in 1513 and dedicated to Lorenzo de' Medici, who became ruler of Florence that year. There's continuous debate as to whether Machiavelli wrote The Prince as a satirical piece or as a sincere gift to Medici as a way to regain the powerful family's good graces. Regardless, the theories he proposed in this book coined the now famous term Machiavellian, used to describe a manipulative person in power. But there's no debate about the fact that the book was written as a gift addressed directly to its intended reader, Lorenzo de' Medici, who ruled Florence from 1513 to 1519, following his uncle Giovanni de' Medici, who became Pope Leo X. Pope Leo X was the second son of Lorenzo the Magnificent. He's known for being one of the most extravagant Renaissance popes and a pivotal figure in establishing Rome as a political and cultural powerhouse. When the Medici family returned to Florence in 1512, Leo helped reestablish the family's power and named Lorenzo, his nephew, ruler in 1513. That same year, Leo was elected Pope at the age of 37. He spent huge sums of money on making Rome the cultural center of Europe, commissioning works from artists Raphael and Michelangelo. This was a position he took rather reluctantly, as he preferred Rome and had little interest in Florentine affairs. In 1516, the Pope made him Duke of Urbino. When Machiavelli dedicated The Prince to Lorenzo de' Medici, he wrote, "If you diligently read and study it, you will recognize my extreme desire that you should attain to that eminence which fortune and your own merits promise you." While The Prince was intended to serve as a form of counsel for the young ruler, it's unknown as to whether Medici actually read it. Machiavelli's goal is to gain the approval of Lorenzo by giving him an extended analysis of how a prince, like Lorenzo, can rule over his domain stably and prosperously. Machiavelli feels suited to give such an analysis because of the years he spent studying history and working in Florence's government before the Medici family came back into power. The Prince switches between the past, present, and future tenses in order to relate the behavior of successful rulers in the past to inform their present and generations to come. Machiavelli relates this information to how a ruler in his own time should behave to ensure the stability and prosperity of his reign. While the term prince usually refers to the male heir of a noble family, in The Prince, it refers to the hereditary ruler of a domain, or a principality. The Prince is a manual for how to effectively govern. Before giving his advice, Machiavelli carefully outlines numerous distinctions. These deal with the ways a prince's domain may be structured, and the ways a prince may acquire this domain. The distinctions feature prominently in Machiavelli's explanation of the success or failure of historical rulers, which in turn determines what he judges to be good advice for a prince. Machiavelli argues that all governments are either principalities, domains ruled by one person, or republics, domains ruled jointly by citizens. By his own admission, none of this advice is meant to explain how a republic can be successfully ruled. Anything he states about republics relates to how a prince should deal with them as the ruler of a principality. One of the key themes in the book shows up right away: class, which is primarily an issue of a person's birth. Nobles are born noble, and commoners are born common. The interests of these two classes are and always will be in conflict. A prince has to avoid the hatred of both as much as possible. A prince must concern himself primarily with the commoners. Because commoners are more numerous than nobles, their hatred is way more dangerous to the stability of the state than the hatred of the nobles is. This constraint features heavily in all of Machiavelli's arguments regarding the behavior of an effective prince. Generally, Machiavelli's suggested rules are simple. An effective prince does what is necessary to ensure the prosperity and security of the state, even when what is necessary involves acting in ways that are usually viewed as immoral. Another theme here is necessary evil. A necessary evil is an action that is immoral, but must be done for practical reasons. Machiavelli frequently advises that the effective prince should not be worried about doing evil things that are necessary to preserve his state. The sorts of evil Machiavelli refers to are primarily acts of cruelty and deceit. Throughout the prince, Caesar Borgia and his father, Pope Alexander VI, are given as examples of how cruelty and deceit can be used appropriately to gain and maintain territory. Machiavelli counsels the prince not to flinch from the path of effective governance. Machiavelli's rules cover legislative, executive, military, and diplomatic activities. There's no mention of how a prince should conduct his personal life. Indeed, Machiavelli gives the impression that there is no such thing for a prince. Instead, all of a prince's time should be devoted to winning glory for himself by expanding his domain and ruling it prosperously. So life for a prince isn't always super fun. The ranges of historical examples in The Prince stretches from ancient Persia, Greece, and Rome to other areas of Europe in Machiavelli's own time. Machiavelli provides examples of both effective and ineffective behavior from each of these time periods and makes an effort to deal with examples that might give reasons to doubt the universality of his advice. Another main theme of the book is the lessons of history. Effective princes should model their behavior after those leaders in history who've achieved greatness and ruled stable and prosperous domains. Machiavelli states that every detail, from the movement of troops in battle to the conduct of political affairs, ought to be modeled in this very way. Machiavelli warns that new methods untested by others have an uncertain chance of success and are likely to be viewed with suspicion by a prince's subjects. Human nature makes people hesitant to support actions that they are not sure will benefit them. They're likely to defend actions that have benefited them, or at least not harmed them, in the past. Toward the end of The Prince, Machiavelli focuses his observations and advice on the rulers of Florence. He claims that Italian princes have not succeeded in ruling with stability and prosperity because they have acted contrary to the best practices outlined in this very book. They have not followed the examples set by the great rulers throughout history. Addressing Lorenzo Di Piero de' Medici and his family, Machiavelli claims that Italy can be made great again if the rulers would only follow the lessons in The Prince. Machiavelli considered himself to be a politician and a historian, not a philosopher. However, The Prince presents a basic philosophical position, that the function of a principality is to perpetuate and defend itself. Everything Machiavelli advises is based on that assumption. Threaded throughout the text are animal symbols, two real, one mythological, the lion, the fox, and the centaur. The lion is a symbol of courage and ferocity in many cultures and features often in the insignia of noble houses. And in The Prince, it symbolizes the straightforward and warlike nature an effective prince must be able to exhibit in order to win glory and respect. The lion is one of the two beasts a prince should emulate, according to Machiavelli. Its strength is that it can frighten off wolves, or those that would threaten the lion's domain. The wolves in this case are the rival princes who also want glory. The lion's weakness is that it is defenseless against traps. Here, the traps refer to bad fortune and the deceptions of rival princes. The fox symbolizes cleverness and deceit. Because of its small size, it must outwit its prey rather than overpower it. An effective prince, when dealing with enemies who are dangerous to face in straightforward combat, is advised to be like a fox. Where military might cannot prevail, the prince should be clever and deceptive. Clever, like a fox. The fox's strength is that it can recognize traps or bad fortune and deceptions that a prince must be prepared for in order to preserve the stability of his domain. The weakness of the fox is that it's defenseless against wolves, who will drive the fox from its home. The wolves are the rival princes who are always looking to expand their territories. Now, centaurs are Greek mythological creatures that are half horse and half human. In The Prince, this creature represents how humans are part beast. An effective prince must realize this and be able to freely channel the human and bestial parts of his nature to deal with enemies and subjects. Machiavelli points out the beast-like side of humans when he claims they are wretched creatures who will not keep their word to you and will instead seek their own personal interests. This is a consistent notion all throughout The Prince, the notion that humans are always out to benefit themselves. Another additional main theme that the text speaks to is practicality. Beastly as they are, people are often practical. The Prince does not describe a political utopia. Machiavelli argues that the effective prince faces the world as it is and adapts his behavior to it, rather than trying to force the world to fit any idealistic principles. Part of this practicality involves a picture of human beings as being primarily motivated to maximize benefit and minimize harm to themselves. This theory of human nature directs how the effective prince can avoid his subjects' hatred and ensure their obedience. The Prince was written to convince the Medici of Machiavelli's ability as a scholar of politics and history, but its author Machiavelli's full return from exile was stopped during the second overthrow of the Medici in 1527, followed by Machiavelli's death only a month later. Almost 500 years later, The Prince endures as a complicated, thought-provoking work of philosophy. Rulers, subjects, scholars, and minds for leadership continue to discuss and debate.